Yeah, well, thanks everyone for joining in. A lot of you know, my name's Ian. I've got a channel on YouTube, Mick Fox Back. I just want to start by saying a quick prayer. Father in Heaven, I pray in the name of Jesus that you bless this show, and that this show is all about you. It's all about bringing the truth, opening the eyes, bringing people to your glorious kingdom, and sharing the love that you brought and that Jesus taught us, that is in our instruction book, that we're trying to get people to open and trying to take off the shelf and blow the dust off it and realize that all the truth is in that book. And I pray in the name of Jesus that people's eyes are open to the truth, and everything on this show comes from the Father and gives glory to the Father. Amen. Okay, guys, I've got a brother with me here, Brother Junior, who is, I'll let him introduce himself now.
Nobody special, the least of all men, just here to support the Bible and the Word of God and how it plays into the whole New World Order. And hello to everybody.
Where are you, Junior?
I'm hailing from Toronto, Ontario, Canada.
Awesome. So, Junior, you know, me and you have been talking now for how long have we known each other?
I don't know. It already seems like years, brother.
It does. We've spent, you know, quite a few hours talking on Skype now. So I think I actually blame you for my headset breaking.
I could, you know, send you some money PayPal.
Yeah, well, it might be, even that'll get, the way Skype's going, I think we'd get a paper cup and string.
And perhaps.
Revert back to the OJ.
Perhaps.
Yeah, so, okay, everyone, so we're going to try giving this a go. Me, nor Junior, have done anything like this before. We're going to give it a test run, see how things go, and all we want to do is carry out God's will and bring the truth, because the truth is being suppressed. We can't rely on mainstream media. So we're going to see how this show goes. It's only a short show for about an hour. So I appreciate all of you guys' feedback, or if you have any suggestions on how things could be improved, it's all welcome. So, Junior, we're going to start tonight. We're going to talk about Hollywood pushing this 2012 agenda, yeah?
Yes, for sure. Where do you want to start?
Well, yes, we're actually in the year that they've been pushing, 2012. As you know, you sent me that video, didn't you? What's it called again? Is it Hollywood's War on God, isn't it?
By Pastor Joe Schimmel. He's located in, I think, Southern California, just like Felicia, I believe. I could be wrong, though.
Yes, it's very good video, isn't it?
Yeah. It does a really good job of laying out basically how the New World Order, or basically these elite, how they're pretty good at weaving into movies and cinema, media, all the ideas about Freemasonry, the coming of a false Christ, so on and so forth.
Yeah, that's it. And I mean, it's something we've got to watch out for, the Gnosticism that they're really, you know, it's a huge deception, isn't it?
Well, I would tend to agree, because, I mean, the main aim, from what we all are learning at different levels of the journey, is that they want to basically be their own gods. They don't want Jesus Christ. They don't want to have their own God. They want to be their own. And it's the ultimate lie. It's, you know, what Satan told Eve in the garden, that, you know, ye would be like as gods, so on and so forth.
Yeah.
But I think, the best way we could look at it, and well, not the best way, but one way we could look at it is that they're pushing much harder because they weren't able to get it in 1984, which was the date that they really were hoping for.
Yeah. I mean, the deception we're facing at the moment is huge, but God is bigger than anything, and we've got the instruction manual, haven't we? Carry on.
I was saying, yes, we do, yeah.
So basically, everything we need, we have from God's word. Do we have a link to all that we can put in the chat room for that Hollywood's War on God, so everyone can look at it? Do we have that available? Or?
I guess what I could do, yeah, I could right now just find a link for the audience that's there.
Okay, just in case you guys that listen haven't seen this, it will give you a good idea of the slyness and how subtle they're being on twisting everything and trying to take us away from the truth and take us away from God. They're doing everything. They're tempting us through technology. They're tempting us through immortality, and they're going to be offering all sorts. They will offer, well, just as I guess Satan did when he said to Jesus, If you give me homage, I will give you this kingdom. And, you know, it's just going to show you how much they are willing to offer to take us away from God. But it is with God and with God alone that we will have eternal life, peace, truth, happiness, love, and everything that we need is with God.
Amen. But it consists also of, you know, the hard walk of when we say we believe, pretty much believe means you actually walk the walk. You don't talk the talk. If we are going to say we're believers, it would only make sense that, you know, if you believe in something so strongly, you would change your whole life to suit what, you know, God has commanded. And
just like where it mentions, you know, there's no lukewarm. You gotta be hot, right?
Hot or cold, as in Revelation, yeah. Hot or cold.
I guess it's a little bit like, you know, in this story, there's only two sides of the fence, isn't there? Either with God or with Satan.
Well, I'm sure you recall many times Jesus made clear that he who is not with me is against me, and it's a very sobering command by Jesus, because when he asks us to die to self, he literally means that everything of the world that is a form of idolatry, everything that is something that you put before God, you know, that is something we have to die to. That is our basic tenet, that as a Christian you're literally not in the extraterrestrial sense, but you are an alien to the earth, because our kingdom is of heaven, right? Our kingdom is of the city of the new city of Jerusalem. We're citizens of the new city of Jerusalem, and our mission here is to basically try our best to lead souls to Christ, and through example and, you know, in love, but also in truth. And sometimes the truth hurts, and sometimes it will make you mad, but it's better that you hear the truth rather than somebody, you know, tell us that a half-truth, which is basically a lie, right?
Well, that's it. You know, I mean, a lot of these followers of, well, you know, people like Jay-Z and a lot of the pop culture who have been promised the world, you know, they're going to live the lie. They're going to live the lie for 5 minutes, and they think it's a false sense of happiness, a false reality, with their big houses, their sports cars, and all the other nonsense that goes with it. But the real essence and the real gold, which is tried in the furnace, is walking in the Spirit and that eternal life with God. You know, the Spirit means more than anything, and you know, a lot of people need to understand that it is true that this battle is not against flesh and blood. It's a battle for souls, isn't it?
Amen, because I mean, we war not against powers that are flesh and blood, but of spiritual powers in high and wicked places.
Yeah, yeah.
I think
so,
that's what...
carry on.
I think what... we all make the mistake as when we first come to Christianity, as you know, baby Christians, we tend to think that it's customary to rebuke the person, or actually the man or woman. But if we realize through Ephesians 6:12, we're warring with the Spirit within that man or woman, whether it, you know, if it's not with God, it's against God. And you know, it's just interesting because there's so much deception, and the only thing that we have right now is the Word of God, and that's the only thing we ever really need to be able to use as eyesight to look into everything else, right? I mean, when you read the Bible, you are putting on God's eyes. You are having somewhat like an X-ray vision where everything is naked before the Lord. So, but
Sorry to interrupt you, Junior.
No,
but do you remember, we were talking the other day, do you remember about all the deceptions going on? And one of them, we were talking about the sacred name movement. Do you remember that? We were talking about the name Jesus and everything. Well, we've actually just had a question come in. Ian and Junior, what are your thoughts on the possibility that we are being fooled into calling the wrong name for the Father? You know that Baal means Lord. How many other false names are in the Bible? I was reading the website yesterday, and this is what has made me ask the question. Is it possible that this is the lie, that his name has been hidden from us deliberately?
Well, I believe more it's a lie that that there's a particular name for God that we have to use, in the sense of I'm not speaking about other religions. I'm speaking about, like, Baal may mean Lord, but out of Baal you get the word cannibalism, cannonball, right?
Yeah.
And we always have to remember that Satan has been at this game for 6,000 years, and he's a lot smarter than most people could ever dream of. He has an IQ of like a trillion, so he could extrapolate many different things much with a higher accuracy than we could. And he always is taking and stealing from God. He's always perverting and reversing what God does. He's always making it an alteration, a manipulation, and he does not create. So for me personally, from what I see, what the scripture says is that Lord is Jesus made clear he's the Lord of lords. So even if it was true that Baal means Lord, which it does, and I believe it's Akkadian or Sumerian, I'm not sure. But even if it does mean Lord, as it has been said to, still Jesus is the Lord of all lords, right? And we could still use Lord, the name of Lord for Jesus. It might be added also too that, see, it was an old... if one does their research into this and doesn't get flustered by all the, you know, the so-called sounding truth, what I've noticed is that this is part of what's called the sacred name cult, and this is a movement that's emanating out of the Hebrew roots movement, where they feel that if we don't use the name of Jesus, or Jesus means Zeus and whatnot, heaven forbid that Jesus wouldn't save somebody who's getting raped or murdered because they weren't calling on the right name of Jesus.
That's it. Well, you know, God knows our hearts, doesn't he? You know, because to be honest with you, like I was saying when we were talking about this, I said that I was very new in my walk to Jesus Christ at the time, and I was on YouTube, and the whole sacred name movement came across me, and I've got to say, with no shadow of a doubt, I've never had such rude attacks and horrible things said to me. And anyone new in Christ, I would have thought it'd be such a hurdle for them. And it's like they're obsessed. They're obsessed with these worldly words, which then I prayed to God. And he basically said to me, well, he pointed me in the direction of where the whole babble come from, you know, because they thought they knew their words so well. They'd have their own language. And he cast them, you know, he turned their language to babble, didn't he? So one of the things that I used to do then, I actually come to call the sacred name movement the sacred hatred movement. And what I would say to, if, you know, I'd get attacked for using the name Jesus, they would say it's like Jesus. So I would reply to them on the comments saying, well, did you know that I was actually talking to God, or are you insinuating I'm praying to the devil? And they'd say, oh no, we know that you're praying to God. So then I'd say to them, well, you're telling me that you know who I'm praying to, but God doesn't. So, doesn't that make sense?
Well, it makes sense to me. See, this is what Paul was talking about throughout Corinthians and Galatians and in the other epistles, that we were not to be caught up with Jewish fables. And it's all an attempt to bring us back to Levitical law. And Levitical law, you know, you're saved by your works. You're not saved by the grace. See, that's why for Abraham he was counted righteous, because he believed God, right? He had faith. And it's through grace. Yeah. It's you know, grace is a gift from God as well as faith is, and it's by grace and faith that we are saved. It's nothing that we could do of ourselves. But the Hebrew Roots movement, what it tries to do is bring us back to that. You know, where it's a works-based theology, where you gotta tithe, you gotta make sure you go to church, you gotta do all this ritualistic, ceremonial type of behavior that it's not really being done with the understanding that you know you're not good enough to save yourself. You don't do the works to get saved. You do the works because you're saved, right?
Yeah. They're just adding to the confusion, aren't they? They try and add to the confusion, and what it reminds me of, basically, is the Council of the 1700s, of where basically Satan, he personally tutored Darwin into the evolution theory, and he also talks about bringing in the New Age movement.
Mm-hmm.
Excuse me. But one of his main goals was to destroy the Bible without burning it. So, you know, these same people are going around trying to bring all these stories saying stupid things like, oh, Paul was the Antichrist, and, the Hebraic movement like you're talking about. It's all these little things that they're trying to slowly take away from the Bible, page at a time. I've even heard some people saying, oh, you know, the whole flood thing was a myth. It just goes on and on. So basically what they're trying to do is like turn a page out of the Bible, oh, that doesn't count, that doesn't count. So in the end, we'd be left with nothing. So it's a huge, huge deception.
Well, this is why, you know, the Lord ensured us that we are to mark those who cause division and mark those who actually do walk the walk. A prime example is with what you wanted to speak on about Hollywood and how they always have the reoccurring theme of the, you know, you have the good guy and the bad guy, but it's always done from a Luciferic Masonic point of view, where they'll put the bad guy will be, you know, the hero, and will be the rescuer, will be the knight in shining armor. Meanwhile, the bad guy is always actually Jesus being put as the bad guy in the Masonic view. Because we're aware that these bloodlines of the Illuminati, they do believe very much so that Jesus and Lucifer were brothers, and that, you know, Lucifer was just misunderstood, you know, and that he's actually the good guy. He was trying to help out mankind.
Totally twist in it. I just wanted to mention as well that, you know, because it still amazes me, I think about it quite often. Do you remember Pete, the guy that I was praying for, who got healed of that aggressive tumorous cancers in his throat?
Yeah, and he got healed.
Yeah, and I was praying in the name of Jesus, so let that be another answer as well to what we were just talking about. So...
Yeah.
Okay, so Hollywood then, for a while now, they've been pushing all these films about 2012. One of the scenarios they're pushing is the end of the world, aren't they?
All based on a false Mayan prophecy.
Yeah, that's right. Well, it's just the other day that, you know, when you're awake and when you're understanding what's going on, all glory to God, all praise to God for opening, you know, some of our eyes, all of a sudden, they've decided to stop pushing this end of the world scenario. And they've actually said that, oh, they've misread the Mayan tablets because there was a crack in them. And now they're saying what it actually says is this return of the Son of the Creator. So what do you think Scripture tells us about that?
Well, I know you know as well as I do that... no man know the time or the hour, but we know by the seasons and the signs. And
yeah.
We should know by, like, when a fig leaf, you know, falls, when the figs fall from the tree in an untimely manner, which seems to be accelerating now. I mean, with the way they're pushing, like, for example, in the Hollywood movies, we find that the transhumanism is just so prevalent now in the last, I would say, 10, 12 years, ever since they, you know, didn't get their Y2K, because that was the... There are some people who say in a joking manner that, you know, Y2K was their last attempt. And
yeah,
now they're trying again in 2012, and it very much will be so that they are going to try and throw everything they can at it. And Hollywood is an extreme way they're doing it. It is quite the vehicle and mechanism. They can do it to program us and to program the populace, right?
Yeah, they're trying to program us through all the fear tactics of the movies. Not only that, they're trying to push all this sexual content as well to take away people's, you know, to be more Christ. You know, they're pushing all of the things that we shouldn't be doing, and it's all working synchronized, like with the fear tactics and all the films, 2012. It's all working in synchronization with things like HARP, isn't it? Because they seem to be ramping that up every so often, and it's one big game for them, isn't it?
Well, I can't disagree with you, obviously, on that. We're dealing with families that have been intermarrying for so long that the media, like, their agenda that they're basically putting out is everything that has to be happening in an incrementalization type of way. In these Hollywood movies, as you were saying, they do a really good job of doing this because they're preparing us, right? They're preparing the masses to accept a delusion, to accept a false Christ. You know, we'll have the false prophet, the Antichrist, and they keep retelling the same story through the movies whether it be from, I believe the movie was in 1975 with Sean Connery, and I can't recall the name of the movie right now. But again, where they play the whole idea that, you know, you have two men that stumble in, they're taken as gods. You know, they become treated like royalty. One wants to stay, the other would like to go, so on and so forth. So they keep playing with this idea that, you know, the end of the world, because we're almost nearing the full implementation of all microchipping of human beings. We're facing the serious war that we're against with the chemtrails, and everything that's in the chemtrails poisoning us, the very air that we breathe. And there's just, yeah, like I agree with the Hollywood. For example, in the battle for LA, they want to continually re-impress upon the people the idea that what we're fighting is somehow coming from other planets and coming from other galaxies and whatnot. And it's nothing but a charade, because when we look at old sorcery and old witchcraft, and we look at the way the interactions were with the sons of God in the Old Testament, who were actually the angelic beings, when we see how they interacted, it was always the fallen angels interacting with the daughters of men and the men, so on and so forth. So,
well, that's why I was just mentioning, you know my thoughts on this already, Junior, about why they're trying to get everyone so sexually frustrated and sexually wound up. Everywhere we look, even on, you know, breakfast television, when, you know, kids can be watching, not that I have a TV, but I just know this, everything is sexual content, isn't it?
Well, they have to... they have to bring us to the level of depravity.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, you remember I was saying as well that I think they are actually working on these beautiful-looking clones, which goes back to Nazi times, Dr. Mankella trying to create the blue-eyed, blonde-haired. So, you know, would it surprise you if part of this alien deception to reinvest the world with the Nephilim, just as the days of Noah, would be from them creating human-like clones that give birth to Nephilim?
Amen. Yeah, that's basically what was going on.
Yeah. But, I mean, there's so much stuff going on with the cloning, and yeah, I'm not quite sure exactly what it's going to be about, but it's just a deception, I see, where they're this whole Pelagian and Nordic thing. I would not be surprised at all if... And also, a lot of people have dreams of where they've seen beautiful-looking beings getting off these spaceships. Now, wouldn't that tie in with all of this sexual content they're putting, and not to mention also just about every music video has got that dating site, Plenty of Fish, where you can go on and you yes and no the women you like, and they could quite easily create a clone designed specifically for a specific person. Now, you know, there's no doubt they're logging everything they can about us, so they're trying to get everyone all wound up sexually, and they're probably creating these clones that are going to come down, because it's going to be somehow that they reinfest the world with the Nephilim, and you know, just as the days of Noah, so there will be the coming of the Son of Man.
Well, see, I'd like to add to what you're saying, because not only what you're saying is right, you know, biblically bad, but also the fact that really what this is, it's the return to Babylon. This is really what this whole New World Order is about. And pretty much, it needs, like, let's think back at the at the time of Babylon, everybody spoke one tongue. Everybody, there was no problem understanding one another. There was, plenty of pagan sodomy, pagan worship of gods. If anybody who studied a bit of archaeology and anthropology, they will know that in over 300 cultures, we always have sun worship. And this is why people must be very careful of the Zeitgeist movement, because they promote like a historical fallacy to say that the story of Jesus coming and the story of Jesus coming was already foretold by the Egyptians. But why haven't they told you the part that Abraham, Isaac were already prophesizing about the coming of Jesus and the coming that he would be born of a virgin? And then if we could even go back as far as Genesis 3:5, where the first prophecy was that the seed of the woman will crush the head of the serpent. And pretty much it's we understand that from the Christian perspective and the born again, Bible believing, blood bought, ready to be martyred for Christian type point of view. We realize that, you know, we are really, this Hollywood, the effect that it's having on just the children, for example, and how now the children, I believe it's the Bratz dolls that they totally promote, like, promiscuity and causing, you know, eight-year-old girls to actually think that they should look like an 18-year-old, 19-year-old, 20-year-old girl. And this is only in embellishing and engendering more of the opportunity for them to accept pedophilia as something normal, and to say that it's okay, you know, to take advantage of a little child. And, you know, when children are innocent, you know, this is where I also feel with the Hollywood movies that they're reaching forward to on a very spiritual, subconscious way, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I watched, I've seen an advert of The X Factor, which was on the internet, and I just could not believe my eyes. I mean, there was this girl, and I'll tell you who she was as well. She was actually, I think it was Will Smith's daughter, actually. And, I mean, she's only like between 11 and 12, 13, something like that. And she's very scantily clad, and the body movement she's making with sexual innuendos, it's just absolutely, it's warped. It is warped. And I can't believe how they're allowing this, you know, to go there. Because as you're saying, you know, the kids aren't being given a chance these days. They're bombarded, absolutely bombarded with these satanic energy drinks, Monster energy drink that has actually got Hebrews 666 on it. excuse me, they can't even watch TV without, you know, having some sort of satanic agenda being forced on them. Which I think, you know, it's all been prepared, and it's to do with Tavistock, Montauk, and the MK Ultra, which, as you know, Junior, you know, they were doing experiments on young children there, weren't they?
Yeah, and for a mighty long time. And apparently, I have researched this topic to some length, but I know that there's always more that one research that could be done. And I believe that they're still running it. They're still running the program. Like, everything right now is pretty much a psyop. Everything you see in the movies, everything you see on mainstream news, it's all it's all fabricated. It's all there to provide you a reality that is not really the case, but one that they want you to believe exists in order for them to continue to push their agenda.
It's a bit like the scenario in the Matrix, isn't it? They are actually trying to put us in the tank, so to speak. They're going to connect you up to this machine where you do nothing, you feel nothing, but you just think you are.
Pretty much, yeah, I agree with you. It's like there was a scene, and I don't know how many people in the chat room have seen it, but there's a movie called Network, and there's a scene in there where one of these elite internationalist globalists, he has a talk with a radio show host, and he basically, or a TV show host, and he basically shows the perfect example of how the elite are, they don't think like us, they don't, they do not have the same mentality because of this interbreeding. You know, they end up as like spiritually intergenerationally linked demonic leaders, if you'd like to put it like that, right?
Yeah. Well, I mean, you know, all the leaders, you know, look what they just brought back into, well, not over here, they haven't done it yet, but the sodomy, you know, it's all going back. You know, one of my opinions is because, you know, the Knights Templars and all of that, well, in their rituals, they have to use sodomy and, you know, are they doing this so they don't get arrested so they can carry out their rituals? What do you think about that?
Well, what would you, like, you would agree, obviously, that when you need to, okay, when you need to get a populist to lose their moral sensitivities, to, you know, totally fall out of a God-designed society and then come into a New Age society. And I like to call it New Age and not New Age, because New Age rhymes with sewage. And Basically, this whole New Age society, it all plays in, right? Because they're expecting the Maitreya, they're expecting their Christ, and in order to keep the society depraved or continuously get them incrementally depraved, you need to keep breaking down their moral structure, their moral fabric. And I believe it's still going to get a lot worse before it gets better, because, you know, the Lord did say that, you know, perilous times will come. You know, men will be lovers of themselves, so on and so forth. And the Hollywood movies are a great route to it. Like when you were cite the example that you were giving me before about what was it? Sum of All Fears.
Yeah. That's the one. Where the plot is where a nuclear device is placed inside a Super Bowl stadium, isn't it? And it's also got the president is at the game, and this nuclear device goes off. And I think they blame it on Russia, don't they?
Well, the elite, as we know from our studies, right, and anyone who researches it in general and uses the Bible as their lenses, making sure that they go from the Bible, like you read what's in the scriptures, and then you find confirmation out of the scriptures. You don't read something from out of the scriptures and then go back to the scripture to find confirmation, because that's a violation of the text. Yeah. And what we'll find is that, you know, Satan really is using man as a tool to achieve his gain. He's building his own army. And this is why we're seeing a lot more of the transhumanism in the movies. Well, we've actually been seeing it already with the original RoboCop, and I know that it was done in movies in the 70s and 80s, but ever since the reality of being able to merge with machine has become a total possibility now, and when they're doing it as we speak.
That advert that was in the Super Bowl, did you see that baby that was in that advert? Like electronic device fitted into the baby's back. I mean, every chance they're getting, they're pushing this new agenda of theirs, aren't they, this transhumanism?
Well, it's the new form of eugenics. It's a way to get our DNA corrupted, right? As in the days of Noah.
Yeah, on the days of Noah, that's what it was total corruption. Total corruption of the DNA, wasn't it?
Well, it was Genesis, I believe, was it Genesis, where Noah, Genesis 6, or Genesis 6 is where they discuss, I believe, the the Fallen Angels, if I remember correctly. But Genesis 3 or what I believe were the immediate after effects of like Noah being chosen out of like the whole world and is in the seven others as being non-genetically corrupted. We see that, pretty much the whole world was genetically tainted with Nephilim blood, or some different levels, obviously, of it, because they were sinning against the animals, the birds, the fish, so on and so forth.
Yeah. I mean, we're seeing it. We're seeing it now. We're seeing it unfold, aren't we? And, you know, like you said, things are going to get worse. It's going to be like the days of Noah. And, you know, the cries went up to heaven because mankind was so distraught by all the things they were seeing going on because of the Nephilim and their evil ways, and they were bloodthirsty, and, you know, it's been pushed. It's quite unbelievable, really, how people are not seeing this, and yet they choose to believe a lie. Exactly everything. Everything, just as God said, is happening.
Well, also, you could also, in addition to that, you could consider that, for example, in 2 Thessalonians 2, as anyone who might be familiar with the passage would know, that the restrainer, who basically would be God in this case, is holding the restrained, being the devil, right?
Mm.
Still, Satan has to come to power into the temple, whether it be firstly on the spiritual level and then a physical level, which is the actual temple that they're building. That, see, what is interesting is I ran across an article recently where they were, they being Al Jazeera, which was, I believe, the news agency, was already speaking on how the Edomites, not the true Jews, who are the synagogue of Satan. The Edomites are the synagogue of Satan, which is what Jesus is describing in Revelation 2:3, that they've already plotted out where they're going to build the temple, and they've already made it cut out. So, and they're all prepared. They're all ready to make the temple. So there we have confirmation that there is a physical temple, but first it will be spiritual, because Jesus did say that our bodies are the temple of God. Like, know ye not that your bodies are the temple of the Holy Spirit? So on and so forth, right? And what we can see from that is that it will firstly be a spiritual takeover, and then the physical takeover.
So I guess maybe because it's so... what they're pushing with the whole, the physical and the spiritual, I mean, because this whole aid and deception as well is, I mean, this Galactic Federation of Light, they are telling their listeners that they are going to come down and transform them, and they're going to offer them things like immortality, aren't they? So, you know, could this be, you know, what is the mark of the beast actually going to, you know, in my mind, I guarantee is going to corrupt and change DNA, because it talks about how it brings up boils and blisters on those who have taken the mark of the beast, doesn't it?
It could, yeah, that is, it's, see, we have, and from what I've learned, I mean, I'm nobody special, but I know that, I do stay in the Word daily, and that I like to consider myself a born-again, Bible-believing, blood-bought Christian, right? Ready to be martyred.
Amen.
And that could seem a very a truthful case to that, that these swords that are being spoken about in Revelation could actually be a result of what they're doing, because I don't know if the people that are listening know, but recently... Bill Gates bought pharmaceutical company Merck, and if anybody knows the evilness of both companies, this should be something serious that they should consider, because if you have a pharmaceutical company company joining with a software company, then it's pretty much not a far stretch to believe that now you're going to be able to get biological computer viruses.
Yeah, and that's it. This whole Crate Venture thing and stuff he's been working on, the whole vaccine thing, I mean, they're creating viruses with computers, and only these mad scientists that are creating these viruses have the vaccine, because the vaccine has to be created on computer as well, doesn't it?
Well, it would seem that that's where they're going with it, right? I mean, eventually when everybody's got microchips, you could write code to basically do anything you want. And I mean, who knows what type of abominations they could, they're already, like, before we go to break here, remember how recently it came out in the UK news that there were over 155 hybrids that they discovered that were being done by scientists in the UK that came to light. And they had chicklets, like baby chickens, with alligator beaks. And this makes you wonder, you know, if they're already performing stuff like this, they've already proven that through the DNA, that whatever changes you do in the DNA, it can get reproduced and re-expressed in the following generation. So you have Korea making glow-in-the-dark cats and dogs because they're taking the gene from a certain jellyfish that glows in the dark and inserting it into the embryo or into the actual seed. You got so much of this going on now that once they make it mainstream, you know, it will again, we'll see, there we'll have even more credibility to realize that we truly are in the days of Noah, right?
Yeah.
And anyway, are you ready to go for a break?
Yeah. So, yeah, we're going to have a quick break and a quick refresh, and we'll be back shortly.
Great show, gentlemen. Outstanding response from everybody. And we're going to play a tune by Pastor Howie, who was with us earlier in the week with the Jesus on the Mainline show. And this one is called You Believed in Me.
Chased away all my fears, looking down through time as you hung upon that tree. You knew my name, all that I could ever be. You stayed there in my place without a guarantee. That's why I love you, and from sin away all
Okay, I know we have Junior back with us, but I'm not sure if Ian was away during the music and if he's made it back.
I'm back. Yes, I am back.
Oh, good show. Okay, thank you, Ian, and carry on.
Okay. That's what I wanted to mention was Rusted Star. I remember watching a Rusted Star, listening to a show on YouTube quite some time ago, and I didn't actually know what I know now about things, and I was always wondering exactly what he meant when he said Satan's plan is to destroy us from inside. So obviously now, all glory to God, he's given the wisdom of knowing that, you know, it is DNA and genetically related. Did we talk about that before, Junior? Did I say that?
We were touching on it, I believe, in our own time, where it's the constant aim with the, you know, the square and compass and the Masonic symbol. And basically, it's always the union of the male and female. When we look at the picture of, for example, if anybody has seen a full picture of Baphomet, they'll see that Baphomet is actually a hermaphrodite. And basically, the aim is to bring the human populace into an infertile, unpopulable state. So that basically it'll be, if anybody's ever seen the movie Gattaca provides quite a good example of how they foresee the future. They don't want anybody reproducing but in a lab, and you're going to most likely going to need a license to produce a baby once these designer babies really start becoming common. And it's already all there. It's been written in books throughout 1984, A Brave New World. We have many references throughout speeches that are given by the elite, where they are pushing society. And I think what helped me when I was on my wake up 8 years ago, what helped me understand it really quickly was that somebody put it to me like this. They said, okay, well, imagine you're in an audience right now and you're going to go see a play. And the only you don't even know the title of the play. You're just watching. You just told that the play is about some type of drama. And so you get in the door, you get your ticket, right? You go get your seat, and the show starts. And as you're watching the show, right, as everything is continuing to happen, like you have no idea. You can kind of guess, but right there, the gentleman stopped me and he said, okay. He says, the people on stage, he goes, those are your controllers. He goes, they know the script. They know what's going on. Fine, they may not know as much as God does, right? But they have an idea, and they will. Masons do read the Bible, and they are going to try and fool many born-again Bible believers who are only the true of the Spirit will not be fooled by such things that they are truly of God, right? Because they will play biblical scripture on this, and part of that is the belief that we have to be, you know, eventually become almost one sex, you know, an infertile. That's why we have with the bath. Like discussing the Baphomet symbol, how you always see the intertwining of the sexes, the DNA coil, the double helix, right?
That's it. Yeah, it's everywhere. It's everywhere. I've been seeing it a lot lately as well. The V pointing down, the V pointing up, and when they're joined together, it creates the X. And the X then is what basically is a chromosome, isn't it? Which contains the DNA.
It's what you were just discussing too about what's on these, you know, the 666 drinks by what is it, Monster Drinks?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
You know, they're trying to, it's not just, you know, they're trying to change us in every way possible. It's in the food, it's in the water, it's in the drinks, it's in the vaccines. you know, heaven forbid anyone taking vaccines, because, I mean, apparently, you know, they've got aborted fetuses in them, and they've actually got some sort of docking bay that is in these vaccines. So, you know, would it surprise you if they made them so that anyone who takes these vaccines are the ones who are going to get this H1N1 virus that they are creating? Again, see, it's all about destroying the DNA. But, you know, when we look back then to Egypt, and we see all the hieroglyphs and pictures of half man, half snake, half man, half fish, and it isn't it exactly the same as how they're trying to turn it?
Well, it seems to be the eventuality that, how else could they overtake the population, right? How else could they, ruin the actual genome, but by to degrade it, right? Go on.
Over here a while ago, I think I uploaded the video actually on my channel. It's to do with scientists over here. They were trying to clone half cow and half human. Sorry, I don't mean to use that word. Half mankind.
And they've actually already been doing it. Yeah, they've been doing it for some time.
Well, you know, Dawson, New Mexico.
Well, what we can see, though, when we bring this into 2012 again, they're into Hollywood, they really are pushing these types of vaccines where they can literally change your RNA and your DNA. And as one person was mentioning in the room, it's true, they're starting to make it so that you cannot even go to work unless you take your vaccine shot, you know, and who knows what is in that.
Yeah, I mean, there's been a lot of them films like that. There's that one, I believe it was called Children of Men, where basically mankind has become fertile. Also, there was that film Equilibrium, where everyone has to take this vaccine, and they basically totally lost, well, all their senses, what I got from it was they lost their spirituality.
Yeah, I would have to agree with you. It's the inroads to becoming despiritualized. To become literally, see, that's what brings the interesting part of the zombie theme that they're playing. There's a zombie theme. You'll see that they keep playing with the zombie idea that, you know, the dead will come back to life, but we know that from a biblical point of view that when you're dead, the only being that could put, or the only spirit that could put life back into you is God. And if Satan is given that power to do such a thing, it will be a counterfeit. It would be an absolute counterfeit. So they are going to create purely a Luciferian world order, right?
That's it. I think it might come to a point of where we will have to make a decision whether we stay surrounded by our comforts, our electronics, and basically in the New World Order, or whether we, you know, step out of it maybe and say, right, enough's enough.
Well,
but the way things are changing, you know, because I just want to mention, I don't know, did you hear about them building, they're building cities, they're building whole cities, and they're empty. Have you seen any of them?
This was apparently in, I believe, Asia, right? China?
Yeah, and there's also one in Kazakhstan as well. And it is absolutely full of New World Order symbolism. Pyramids, also this huge sort of building monument that looks semi like the Olympic torch, crossed between a celestial serpent and egg. And I mean, they're building these empty cities everywhere. And I mean, you know, when I seen them, I thought of straight away of that really dodgy Google Doodle mural, that one I covered on Diego Rivera and his wife Frida Kahlo. But the actual Google Doodle on the homepage of Google was, it basically had Mayans in it. But it also, it had this guy, and he was basically, he looked like he was building a new world. And as soon as I seen these new cities being built, it reminded me of that. And it's crazy how, you know, blatantly obvious and in your face they are being with this.
Well, it would seem that I honestly, I'm at a loss of words with that one about the empty cities. Perhaps there's certain, you know, we can only know so much from what I gather, because, well, we only know, for those who are really in depth about, you know, what's going on with the New World Order, it's an endless hole, right? It's an endless, you could go on and on and on and on and studying it, and we only have, our time here on Earth is very short, and from what I have gathered from the Word of God and through my own personal journey with Jesus Christ, and I can tell you that we would be better off studying the Word above all else and using that to view everything else that we do our research on and studies on, because we could get, like, don't get me wrong, there is plenty of knowledge to be gained, but it's all worldly, right?
Definitely studying the Word of God should be number one. And that is where the truth is, and that is the instruction manual. But also, you know, I personally do like to keep an eye on enemy camps.
Of course, we do have to be wise, yeah.
Yeah, you know, and some people are calling out from the watchtowers to those who maybe aren't seeing these things so obviously. So I think, you know, again, it goes, you know, reading the Word of God, and he tells us to love one another. And it's basically, you know, yeah, sticking to the Word and sticking to what he's telling us to do, and not getting too submerged by the things that are going on.
Go ahead, sorry.
You know, because, you know, I do a lot of work on this stuff, and, you know, it's endless. And I do like exposing them, and I do like trying to be a part of, you know, crumbling the foundations of Babylon. But I've got to be honest, every morning I get up, without fail, I pray I'm not deceived. And, because, how many times did Jesus say that in the Bible? I think quite a few times, didn't he?
Yeah, what I think where we go wrong when we're trying to be on this, like, I'm speaking to the Christian listeners and to also the other listeners, whoever are listening, from the biblical perspective, sometimes we could get swayed very easily by, you know, certain pet doctrines and whatnot, and that's why we always have to make sure we stand on the Word, we stand on God, and pretty much from what gets revealed to anyone who fully humbles himself before God and they seek the Lord, they will see that there is no other book like what the Bible is, right? We have testament from archaeologists to anthropologists that testify to the historicity of the Bible. We have archaeological proof, as I just said. You know, many years ago, they believed that one of the cities and one of the peoples described in the Bible was nothing but a myth, right? It was allegory, but they actually found archaeological tablets of the Hyksos, And there was proof that we had actual historicity proof for those who, you know, who lack faith and whatnot, right?
Yeah. I mean, wow, you know, look at how the Bible's come into life more than ever in, you know, in these days. It's absolutely amazing. You know, there's no doubt. I love saying this. It was the author was the Holy Spirit. It was made by a spiritual and mathematical genius. And I just, you know, I hope to have more words to say than that. But it's just so amazing.
Well, we worship a mighty and awesome God who reveals the Spirit to anybody who seeks him, humbles themselves and prostrates themselves before the Lord. And, to anybody who seeks God as a child, with the heart of a child, you know, and the innocence of a child, it will be revealed unto them. I gotta agree with you. When you were just speaking about these cities, at this point in time, since we're aware of it, but what would you postulate would might be like a reason for these cities?
Well, I believe they are setting up because they are so deceived by Satan. He's telling them everything's going to be okay, and I think they are setting up these cities ready for their new world order because, you know, like, who knows what chaos we are facing? I mean, there's a lot of talk of nuclear weapons being used. I mean, if that is the case, then it's going to level a lot of ground and there's not going to be cities left. But, you know, they are planning on moving into their new cities, I guess. But what I don't understand is, you know, how is it they are building these cities and they are so sure of themselves that these cities are not going to fall from an earthquake?
Well, you can see that they are acclimating us with an increasing frenzy now. Like it seemed okay. Well, within the time that I woke up within the last years, it would seem that in the last four or five, they really seem to be pushing hard, right? And
yeah.
I'm not sure if a lot of people know that the Federal Reserve, when they started their first charter to switch us over on a credit and debt system, I believe it was either a 20 or 40 year charter they got. And then when they renewed it, they renewed, I believe it was for 40 years, and now I don't think as many people may know about this important detail, but December 21st, 2012 is the day that the Federal Reserve renews their contract for the world currency.
And, I've heard that date before.
Yeah, and some interesting research that I really came across that I noticed was always suppressed. Not a lot of people were talking about it. And basically, the original Mayan shaman that supposedly gave the prophecy that on December 21st that, you know, there would be this huge cataclysmic type of event. Really, on the Mayan calendar, it was a switchover of the calendar. And on that rock that you described, there was only one rock. And I'm being authentic here. I'm not giving you a side of the story that is only like one side or two sides. I made sure that I have researched all ends of this, and you can see that there was one rock that you'll find that they do have a prophecy that some god was supposed to come down apparently on that day, but not any of this. Cataclysmic type of event, and so when you
were they the rocks it's just recently I've seen the video where they reckon they found these Mayan rocks, and they've got little pictures of UFOs coming out of the CERN. They've even got these little alien beings inside the UFOs. Is that the one you're talking about?
I'm not aware of that one, but...
Just recently they have revealed this. And also, they said that they found this little black pyramid. It's about probably a meter high, and it's got a little green eye at the top, and on the bottom it's got inscribed, when translated, it actually reads, "The Son of the Creator Returns." And also the constellation Orion is then inscribed on the bottom. So that also ties in with the Galactic Federation of Light Deception, because they are saying that this Saint Germain, who also calls himself Jesus, is coming from Orion.
Yeah, it's all the whole bit about these ascended masters that, you know, Samanda Emmanuel, the one that's supposed to look like the, you know, the Catholic Jesus, right?
Yeah.
The long brown hair, blue eyes, when we know that Jesus was from the Middle East and he would have been a shade of brown, right? I'm not going to say if you think of modern day Iraqi peoples and Iranian peoples and modern day Turks and these types of Middle Eastern looking type of individuals, you know, they'll try to use this to promote, you know, the ascended master, this false Jesus Christ, this Maitreya. And so...
Well, as Jesus said, he said, many will come in my name, didn't he?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so...
So it is true, though, that, you know, he was nothing that no one should desire him. And what they're going to do, though, is that with, you know, the help of the Catholic Roman Empire, they will be able to foist upon the people an ecumenical religion. And, you know, that is the move towards the one world government. It's through the Hollywood, as we've been discussing, through the 2012. And I think we should pay particular attention to this one part, though, about the Federal Reserve, because... If we see that it's the banking families behind it, obviously, right? And everything else tends to make a little bit, you know, more sense, that we have the family controlling, you know, a 2012 charade that
they're building the temples as well, aren't they, with their money? Well, not their money.
Say that again.
The Rockefellers, Rothschilds, and they're the same ones who are plowing all the money into building the temples, aren't they?
Yeah, it's hard to single it out. Like, I know that we know a fair bit, but it's an automatic understanding, yes, that obviously they're using all the money and that we work our taxes, and, you know, it's a known fact that our own taxes go straight to the IMF, and that the IRS, same as the CRA in Canada, they're basically revenue bureaucrat strong arms of the law for the IMF, right? And when we consider 2012, you know, do you agree that they're also playing the role, or they're playing into the agenda of Agenda 21, right?
Absolutely.
That man is bad, that we pollute, and that, you know, we need to get off the planet. It's all part of this New Age deception, which Jesus did warn us many times.
It's the same, you know, basically what I'm seeing is I'm seeing the same agenda that Hitler was pushing unfold.
You know, that's a prime example. If I may I read something out that we were commenting on earlier?
Go ahead.
All right. To all our listeners, we just wanted to make it clear, me and Brother Ian, as brothers in the Lord, we wanted to make it clear that we are by the Bible and the Word of God, and preferably the King James, because it is the most reliable, non-corrupted version, which is based on the Textus Receptus, which is the Greek Koine text that was held in Jerusalem. And pretty much anything after 1769 has been edited by Westcott and Hort. And they were known to be occult witches. And they were even part of a secret society guild, one known as the Ghostly Guild. And so we put our faith into the Word of God as being the Word of God in the 1611 to 1769 King James. And if we could read the Greek, we do. And we want to make it clear to our audience that we believe that if God is the one behind the translation of the King JV, since it's a very reliable verbal translation of the Greek Koine text, which was the Textus Receptus, as I mentioned, the majority text, we just wanted to make it clear that we will say things that may not be politically correct, but to be a follower of God, the Word of God is not a politically correct book. And we are being demonized as born-again Christians just for actually speaking up for what the Word of God says. And because we've been, you know, pistol-whipped and sheep-herded into the mentality of a postmodernist mentality where truth is relative, we as born-again believers do know and recognize that Jesus, who is God, who is the Holy Spirit, who is the Almighty, God, hear, O Israel, the Lord God is one, that our point of view on this is that we do have to speak what Jesus commands us, and we do have to stand up for him, because we are not supposed to be clinging to our lives of this world. We were purchased by the blood for the remission of sins, and only God can pull a good out of something evil. And if I challenge everybody to really research out the original manuscripts that were written by the Israelites, who can testify that a 99.5% accuracy over a 2,000, 3,000 year spread about how the King James has been accurate because of the way it's based on the Textus Receptus. See, they never tell you about the Sinaiticus and the Vaticanus, the two copies that were from Alexandria, Egypt. And Alexandria, Egypt was known already by 100 AD to put out a lot of fraudulent copies. And this is what basically all the Bibles after the late 1700s, this is what they've been based on. And I wouldn't trust any of these new Bibles. Now, the reason why I gave that proviso to our listeners is just so that they know where we stand, and we stand on the rock of Jesus Christ, and that, you know, and we stand on the most reliable word we got. So
that video I watched the other day, I can't remember the lady's name, but the video was called The Language of the King James, and it was amazing, an amazing video, and she was basically showing that how the King James Bible has its own dictionary within it. Do you know which video I'm talking about?
Are you speaking on Gail Riplinger's New Age Bible versions? I would suggest all our listeners, if they haven't heard of Gail Riplinger, she is a born-again, Bible-believing Christian, and I will add the proviso that as born-agains, we are all learning from one another. Everybody's at different journeys of their walk. Some are baby Christians still on milk. Some others are on meat. And Gail Riplinger's, I would say, is one on the meat, because she does a very good, extensive, deep study on the King James as it compares to all modern-age, New-Age Bibles. And she shows that...
She was talking about how when they were writing the King James, they prayed and fasted for, I think it was 3 years, was it?
Yeah, I believe a gentleman in one of our chat members brought it up. Yeah, that. See, they could always provide the argument. There's always another argument against it, saying that, well, oh, you know, King James was a homosexual, or he was a king, this and that. But we have to keep in mind, if we're going to be looking at this from a biblical point of view, God is God, and who are we to put restraint on what God can do? If God very much can work through evil people to achieve his gains, right?
Yeah.
Us as mankind, we can't do that. Like, we try to bring something good out of something bad, but we can only do so if it's being done through Jesus Christ, right? But
Well, you know, I solidly believe that the author of the King James Bible is the Holy Spirit, and that is exactly what the corrupt NIV Bible is lacking.
Well, the NIV removed 64,000 words, right?
Wow.
And then we have Revelation 21, I believe, 18 and 19, or 22, 18 and 19, where Jesus is telling us right there that if anybody adds unto the book, I will add to them the plagues, and anybody who removes from the book, I will remove from the book of life. So all the New Age modern editors, what they actually thought, what they actually had happened, was they wrote themselves out of the book of life, right? And
It's actually, what do you say? It's copyrighted over here in the UK, isn't it?
I'm sorry?
The KJV is actually copyrighted over here in the UK, so it can't be changed. Is that right?
Well, yeah, it's only in the UK, but anywhere in the world you could print it for like a dollar. You think? See, I would like to think that God has allowed that on purpose so that everybody could get access to the most reliable version of it, because you like, see, in order to copyright something, right, you need to change it, you know, reduce it in size or add to it, whatnot.
Sorry, carry on, Junior.
No, it's all right, you go ahead.
Yeah, I was just going to say that if they made a mistake whilst writing the King James Bible, they would burn the whole piece of paper and then have a holy bath. Is that correct?
Well, actually, that's with the Hebrews and those who wrote the Old Testament and the New Testament, the Hebrew and the Aramaic and the Old Testament, and then the Greek and the New Testament, that the Israelites, what they would do is if they even made one single mistake, they would actually burn the copy and take a ritual bath. Just because, you know, they knew that there had to be absolute Holy Spirit discernment in writing the Word of God, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
Go ahead.
Yeah, you carry on. What were you going to say?
No, I just wanted to add to that, I just wanted to suggest to anybody in the chat room that if they do want to check out Gail Riplinger, and she has her video on New Age Modern Version Bibles. It's a good study for anybody who wants to see that there is truth to the claim that the King James, not the New King James, but the King James is the inspired Word of God, and that the gentleman who wrote it, whether they were Freemasons or not, God can use all men to impart what he needs to be done. A prime example we could consider is Nebuchadnezzar, you know, out of somebody who was not exactly good at first, he was saved, right? And he was saved because, you know, he humbled himself before the Lord. So if we just humble ourselves before the Lord, we will see that God will reveal these things to us. But we have to trust.
It must have been quite mind-blowing to see two men thrown in a fire and then three men walk out.
Yeah, I got to admit, imagine that if we were there, if we were to witness the three men thrown into that fire and then nothing. What were their names again? Abednego, I don't remember their all their names, but
he ordered for the furnace to be made hotter than ever, and they made it so hot that the two soldiers that threw them in died from the heat from outside the furnace, didn't they?
Yeah, and it must have been quite a surprise. And how could you not want to bow down to a god like that?
Well, that's it, you know. He said, you know, the faith in him is what is going to get us through these times. And with things changing so rapidly, for instance, should we quickly touch on this NDAA that has just been signed over in the U.S. there?
Yeah, I think we could bring that up too, how this relates to the whole Hitler and Nazi cause. What I wanted to read actually was, I kind of got off on a rabbit trail there, I apologize, but what I wanted to read was our stance on what we are in God. And I'm going to be sharing this with the audience members. And so we don't have any, so there are no miscommunications about what our views are on certain topics within the Bible. I'll be reading just a little excerpt from something that has to deal with common law and where we stand on the Bible point of view of what we are in man. So here we go. Origins of the word human. It is a common misconception that the word human comes from the Latin humanus, derived from the words humus, meaning earth or ground, and man. The problem is that the first known use of the word humus was in 1796 approximately, and it came after the first word of humanus, which was coming out of Latin into English approximately around 1384, of which it was supposedly composed. The deception of etymology is to cover up the true origins of the word human. Human is actually a composition of words hue and man, literally meaning the color of man or the appearance of man. The idea of a human is really the idea which would later become race, which was around the year 1300 from some of our best sources. This idea of evolution, that one form of man is superior to the other as a result, is due to gradual development. Thus the expression, human race, ha ha ha, the race of the color of men, ha ha ha. This word is used everywhere and anywhere except one place, the Bible. The Bible, from the 1611 to the 1769 King James, makes it clear that man is not in a race, man is a living soul. Additionally, the appearance and color of that man is irrelevant in the Bible. The kingdom of heaven receives all kinds of man, no matter what color you are. If we look at the later applications of the word human, it is clear to me that humanizing people, or in essence, coloring them, was another way of justifying the idea of race and inferior ape descendants that allowed slaveries and holocausts of Africans, Jews, Natives, and Christians. Atrocities that would not have happened had the Bible and its laws been followed. In conclusion, Hitler talked about the master race, and he learned such things from Blavatsky's Theosophical Society. The Theosophical Society was founded on a combination of Plato's Atlantis and Darwin's evolutionary theory, or on the origin of species by means of natural selection or the preservation of favored races in the struggle for life. These ideas rejected the true God and replaced them with the modern "we're all God" attitude that has swept across much of civilized society. But in reality, the Theosophical Society and its patrons believe they are descendants of Odin and Thor and many other pagan gods that can fall under the Nordic umbrella. All of the nations that have used this reasoning to kill, steal, and destroy, which is all of them, as governments, have been led down this path of destruction, is obviously the work of Satan. Let's leave this word human behind and call ourselves man, woman, and child as God intended. Our kind accounts no color or genetic superiority. Jesus came to give hope to sinners so we all could have a shot at salvation. So this article is pretty much how we stand on what we consider ourselves, me and Ian, as brothers in the Lord.
Yeah.
And we just wanted to share it with our audience so that we're clear that there's no confusion in how we see our particular missions that God has given us.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Is it in Isaiah, it says there will be nothing new under the sun?
Yeah, I believe that's Ecclesiastes. There's nothing new under the sun, yes.
Basically, you know, what we've seen in, with Hitler doing, with his whole New Age agenda, and also what he was doing with, you know, kind of dumbed down all of the prisoners with the fluoride.
We're basically
seeing that now. And also the NDAA taking people captive, you know, for no reason whatsoever. The drones, the fluoride, in my opinion, you know, is pretty much what we are seeing now as one of the reasons for the chemtrails, as well as many other things that we are being bombarded with. You know, the chemtrails, you know, they're filling the atmosphere with it, and no doubt, you know, they're trying to dumb us down, just like they did, Hitler did with fluoride. Obviously, I think chemtrails have been used for more purposes. I think they're linked to HAARP and many other things. But, you know, we're seeing pretty much the same scenario unfold, aren't we?
It does seem that there is going to be, as we move towards the end of the show, it does seem that, recall how in the days of Noah, where God allowed the water that was actually surrounding the planet and the windows of heaven to be open and let that water come down, it almost seems that, see, obviously the saying that history repeats has a reason. And it's because I'd like to think that God is trying to tell us over and over again that he works in, you know, patterns. And we're going to have this strong delusion arise from the skies and out of the earth. So, yeah, it with the fluoride and the chemtrails filling us with chemicals to basically keep us apathetic, keep us blinded down, and even spiritually dumbed down so that we're not aware of what is to come. That is
absolutely
why we profess that, you know, if you're out there listening, give it a shot. Pray to God, get on your knees and prostrate yourself before the Lord and ask him to show you the truth, because if you truly are seeking it, the Lord Jesus Christ will show you the truth.
Amen.
Anything else you wanted to add?
I totally agree with that. I've only been born again for about 3 years now, and what an amazing experience, and all glory to God. He is amazing. You just need to give him a chance. And back in 2009, when my life was in a mess, I put my hands together and prayed to God without even realizing it. And my eyes were opened, and he woke me up to all this deception that was going on. He wants to save us. He wants us in his kingdom. All we got to do is accept his love and, you know, follow and be obedient to him, which is not hard. It's not asking much.
Amen. We just have to we have to die to self, give up our lives for Christ, and always be ready not to cling to our lives, right? To serve one another, since it's the highest thing we can aspire to, right?
Yeah. Work on that spirit. Get the lamp full. Get it full of oil.
Amen.
You know, there's no feeling that this world can offer that will compare to being spirit-filled.
Amen.
So I think we're going to wrap it up, guys, for tonight. We're running out of time. Thank you all for coming and joining us. enjoy your day. Give us a bit of feedback. Thank you, Junior, for co-hosting this with me.
Hey, thank you. It was my honor, brother.
Right, it's all our honor. We're doing this for God.
And hopefully we can do it again.
Yeah. Yeah, we'll certainly be praying about it, I'm sure. So, God bless all you guys. And much love to you. And I look forward to your feedback.
Well, you could probably expect it, Ian. You guys, a great show, first off, and thank you. It's always a pleasure. I enjoy your work on YouTube and your spirit, you know, and a lot of things. Great show, though. The numbers were real close to our best show ever. A strong number two for a first show is outstanding. It was just great. And I want every one of those 47,000 people that you peaked out at to flood your YouTube and insist that you come back here next Sunday. So, no, great stuff. And so hopefully.
Well, thank you, Kevin, for putting this up.
No thanks. The honor is mine, really. And I did throw you under the bus there a couple times in the chat room, Ian, by posting your latest video so that people can go poke you and convince you that, you know, you're doing us a service by being here. And so, you know, expect to have to answer some comments when you get back to YouTube. I hear there's a boycott today, though. I didn't know that. But anyway,
yeah.
Great show. If you're able to listen, continuing on here for another hour, coming up is Pastor Alvarez is going to be joining us, and you guys, and as well as Pastor Alvarez, are both referrals and due to the work of Jesus on the Main Line. So I want to thank all of them, Kathy, Barbara, Jose, thank that team for being so consistent with their shows and bringing other people here to stand up and speak, you know. No matter what you believe or think, Ian, you know, anyone this applies to, I think from my eyes view, if we just at least would get to the point where we'd all sit in the same room and listen, you know, with and forget the boundaries, forget the theory, just listen and be able to rebut without attack and be able to listen without, you know, attacking back, just discuss.
Yeah.
And talk, we'll get somewhere. So you guys bring a lot of that to the table with you.
Well, you know, the truth is sweet, Kevin, and the foundations of truth is rock, and it will not be moved, just like
That's
God's
right.
word is ever.
That's right. And I wanted to ask you, don't you think sometimes, Ian, that it's so simple that people can't believe it? Isn't that one of the stumbling blocks? It's so simple. That
yeah,
we
wow.
live in this technical world. Everything's, you know, so you have to have so much knowledge for any given thing. And for faith and belief, it's so simple that a lot of people can't grasp
it. It's hidden. It's all hidden in plain sight. It's hidden in plain sight, but we're bombarded by worthless mysteries that seem to have taken away, you know, happy family conversations where families would actually talk to each other, people would talk to each other. But nowadays it's like people are either attached to the TV, the latest soap operas, the latest sports event, the latest next technological gadget that's coming out. You know, it's all taking people away from the truth roots and the honey of life.
Yeah, I believe it is. It's a sad day when your president has Jay-Z on speed dial. But I don't want to get into a rant about that, because I will. And we've got to clear the air for Pastor Alvarez. So, gentlemen, thank you very much. And certainly reach out to me and get with me if you're going to be available more often. We hope that you are. And
okay.
That's great. And for all the listeners, stay tuned.